Hello, I'm John Dickerson, sitting in for Gwen Ifill, and this is the Washington Week Webcast Extra. I'm joined around the table by Karen Tumulty of The Washington Post, Todd Purdom of Vanity Fair, Jeff Zeleny of The New York Times, and Eamon Javers of CNBC. Jeff Zeleny, I want to start with you because it comes out of our discussion about the State of the Union. The president, in one of his many proposals, talked about making voting less insane. And he created an odd pairing to fix our voting problems. Who is in this pairing and why is it so odd?
He did. He tapped his own election lawyer, from here in Washington by the name of Bob Bauer. Not surprisingly, you'd want your own lawyer at your side. But what was perhaps a bit of a surprise was he tapped Mitt Romney's top campaign lawyer as well, Ben Ginsburg, who's one of the country's most preeminent Republican election lawyers. He was very prominent in the 2000 Florida recount and in every recount or disputed case since then. But he wanted to bring some credibility to this election, presidential commission on election reform, so he wanted it to be bipartisan. So what they're going to basically do is look at why did some people have to wait 3 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours to cast ballots. Of course, this is a partisan issue. I mean, these two lawyers were on opposite sides all last year arguing over early voting laws and some of these very things. So I wouldn't look for this commission to necessarily solve all these problems, but what they're trying to do is draw attention to some of the problems. And I talked with some Republican lawyers, and they said, even Republicans want people to vote. The criticism from Democrats is that Republicans are behind these long lines. That's not necessarily fair because elections are run locally, and a lot of the reasons are because the equipment isn't there, there aren't enough voting machines, et cetera. So this is drawing attention to something that the president has been putting in every major speech he's done since election night.
He also could be heard walking out of the hall on the night of the State of the Union saying to somebody, I've forgotten who, he said, a lot of these problems are happening in Democratic areas, so it's not about Republicans, it's the local
right.
voting. And it's so
here
it's,
in Washington, D.C.,
yeah.
in Maryland, where it's a Democratic heavy as well. So it is a problem for both parties.
I mean, another thing the president touched on, but did had an executive order on cybersecurity. A lot of people are very nervous about this.
Yeah, this is a fascinating one because you'd think this would be one where everybody would rally around the flag and say, oh my goodness, there's Chinese state-sponsored cyber attacks of U.S. companies. So everybody would in the United States would naturally support what the president did. But it doesn't end up slicing that way because a lot of big chunks of corporate America really feel that this is regulation in another name. And this is going to impose unfair costs. And because it's going to be done from the top down, it's not actually going to work. And so there's deep skepticism among the business community about this thing. I was at a conference this morning at a think tank where some of the White House cyber czars were laying this out in front of an industry audience, and they were falling all over themselves not to use the word regulation or even the word standard, which is a code for regulation. They would only say the word framework. And they're very much adamant that this is a voluntary opt-in program for the companies to share information with the federal government about these cyber attacks. But at the same time, the Obama administration is making the case that the Chinese are stealing so much intellectual property from American companies at this point that, in effect, it is threatening America's economic dominance in the world because so much at the terabit level is being sucked out of the U.S. economy. So it's a real threat, but companies are wary.
Karen, this is an issue that the Secretary of Homeland Security might get involved in, and perhaps if she were running for office, she might get even more involved in it. You wrote about her possible 2016 aspirations.
Right. Well, I have I have had a number of sources tell me that Janet Napolitano, the Department of Homeland Security Secretary, when the discussion comes around to, if Hillary Clinton doesn't run, what woman might, that Janet Napolitano is at least indicating that she might be interested in it. And don't forget that before she came to Washington, she was a very popular Democratic governor of a red state. And she will also be on the forefront of some big issues in the coming years, especially immigration. And so every time I see her go down and make some very visible tour of the border, I think of what I keep hearing.
Thank you for that transition. Speaking, Karen, of people involved in immigration and at the forefront of that debate, you wrote about Chuck Schumer, the senator from New York. I'll let you describe your great characterization of him in the Senate tradition.
Oh, well, there's people are known as either a workhorse or a show horse, and he's actually the push-me-pull-you. He's both.
Yeah.
And I think one of the things that people, it's easy to make fun of Senator Schumer because he's so voluble and he's all over everything, and he wakes up every morning outraged at some fresh new thing, determined to do something about it. But he's also shown himself, especially in recent months, to be the kind of person who has the credibility with both parties to get something going, even if it's just a discussion on guns or immigration. And his very tirelessness, his very sort of ubiquitousness makes him a formidable figure in that way. And he's also, you know, he's now been in Washington for a long time. He's collected a lot of chits. He knows a lot about how things work. And he's determined. It's actually, he's in a Senate that is full of, you know, almost half comparatively new people and some not very impressive characters. He's a worthy heir to the senators from New York, like, you know, Daniel Patrick Moynihan and Jacob Javits. He'll probably wind up in that territory one of these days.
And an interesting mix and model because, as you say, there used to be, when you first came to the Senate, you sat quietly. Now you have two interesting examples of Ted Cruz, the Texas senator, freshman, who's been very out in the forefront on this Hagel, and then Elizabeth Warren, the senator from Massachusetts, who has now again become an internet hero among liberals for questioning bank regulators about who they threw in jail. So you have two examples of new senators trying to find their way into maybe the Schumer mold. We're going to end here now on the piece of frivolity that was at the center of this week, which was Senator Marco Rubio in his response to the State of the Union, had a moment of Jonathan Martin of Politico called it an aqua lunge. he reached for the water. Jeff, this is absolutely weightless in its import in terms of the national interest. However, politics is often defined by the weightless. Matters or doesn't matter in the end for Governor Rubio, and you're all going to have to weigh in on this.
So. Well, sure, as well hydrated.
Yeah, right.
Look, I don't think it matters. It probably distracted a little bit of attention from the substance of the speech, which some of his people are actually fine with. He was carrying some weight of the House Republicans, Senate Republicans. When you're asked to give the official response, you sort of, you know, if he was giving his own speech, it would have probably been somewhat different. So it makes him, it reminds him of, you know, how much work he has to do, how difficult it really is to be in the national stage. He even made a joke about it the next morning, talking to George Stephanopoulos on Good Morning America, saying that, you know, every now and then, I think, you're reminded of how human you are, or God reminds you of how human you are. So I think at the end of the day, it'll be a punchline, because he is a substantive figure. I mean, it's not like he's this man without substance, but he'll never live it down.
Right. And Karen, he sent out a tweet of the bottle of water, the Poland Spring, that he was reaching for immediately thereafter. Now he's raising money off of this. He's turning, I guess, water into lemonade, or lemonade into water. I can't.
Well, I must say, I think the good humor and the self-deprecation that he showed after this will help him. And I thought it kind of spoke well of him afterwards.
You agree, Tom?
It doesn't matter, but it'll never be forgotten. I mean, it'll be a line in his obituary.
Yeah.
I think these gaffes are only fatal if they confirm a pre-existing suspicion about that character. And nobody really thinks that Rubio's a lightweight, as you're saying. So I don't think it confirms that for him.
Or that he's underhydrated.
Yes, right. Exactly. Because we know in these times, an underhydrated president could be a real national security risk.
And, you know, as somebody who spends at least some time on television talking, you know, my heart kind of went out to the guy. I mean, I've been there. If you get that dry, you just can't talk anymore, and you have to do something about it. If anything, it's basic blocking and tackling of the advance team. They shouldn't have had the bottle of water that far away from him. They should have had it on a podium right nearby. The president's team always has a glass of water for the president. Right. So
someone suggested he get a Camelback, one of those tubes that athletes use.
One of those beer hats.
So as his team gets ready for 2016, you know, they'll do this. But look, this is a week where Rubio was knocking down some of the high expectations that he faced. You know, on the cover of Time magazine as the savior, and he had to put out his own tweet saying, "There is only one savior, and I'm not it." You know, this is a guy who has extremely high expectations, and it reminds me of the high expectations in many ways on the opposite party that Barack Obama faced. And those high expectations can be a problem for you.
But Senator Obama played a different strategy. He never gave the Democratic response, and he, you know, was at this point of his career, he was still laying low.
Right. Okay. Thanks to all of you. Thanks, everyone, for watching. We've got to go for now. I'm John Dickerson. Gwen will be back next week with another edition of the Washington Week Webcast Extra.